Hello student, welcome back. We are going to start our today's session. Module 5, Lecture 2, Satellite Communication, MECE 106A, Sangeeta Roy, Assistant Professor, Electronics and Communication Engineering Department, Narula Institute of Technology. Today is the second lecture of Satellite Transponder. In the previous class, we have studied the satellite transponder. It is the subsystem of satellite platform. So, a little bit of previous class we will brush up, then we will go to the today's topic. So, satellite subsystem which provides the connecting link between transmitting and receiving antenna of satellite is known as transponder. It is one of the most important subsystem of the space segment subsystems. Transponder perform the function of both transmitter and receiver, that is to responder in a satellite. Hence the word transponder is obtained by combining few letters of two words, transmitter and responder, that is to transponder. So this is the block diagram of transponder. This is a basic block diagram. Detail will be discussed later. Satellite antenna, duplexer is there, low noise amplifier, carrier processor, then power amplifier and subsequent blocks are there, but this is the main features. So we have discussed what is the specialty of duplexer, low noise amplifier, carrier processor, power amplifier and transponder general characteristics also studied. So this is the typical diagram of relative levels in a transponder. Wideband receiver subsystem, this is the diagram. Channelization subsystem, this is its corresponding diagram, example. This is also some example of how it is multiplexed. So we are going to start today's session. Transponders without onboard processing. Basically, satellite transponders receive, amplify, frequency translate and retransmit various types of communication signals. Wideband as well as channelized transponder configurations can be emphasized. Most of the actual satellite repeater configurations in the fixed satellite service are based on wideband receivers, followed by channelized transmitters. As far as connectivity among different RF channels is concerned, there are two main cases depending on whether the transponders are connecting to a single transmit beam or to several beams. Consider the simple case where the received signal is routed to only one transmit beam. The signals in the receiving band are amplified and translated into the transmit band. Two types of frequency translation may be used. A single conversion system which translates the frequency directly from the received band to the transmit band. A dual conversion system which translates the received signal to an intermediate frequency for part of the amplification process and then translates them again to the final transmit frequency bands. The second type, the dual conversion, is sometimes preferred because it offers the advantage of eliminating potential instabilities due to feedback within high gain amplifying chains. Avoiding cross modulation products or harmonics of the received signals and local oscillator of the frequency translator falling within the desired signal bands and providing a convenient intermediate frequency for switching and cross-trapping between payloads that work with different receive and transmit frequency bands. The disadvantage is that two local oscillators and two frequency translators are used. The transponder provides an amplification of roughly 100 to 110 dB in two stages. Low-level amplification in a wideband receiver followed by high-level amplification by high-power amplifiers in the channelized subsystem. Attention must be paid to electromagnetic compatibility owing to the high gains and large bandwidths involved. Systems operating with several beams are currently in service, that is to Intelsat 4A and 5. These beams can provide independent transmissions. However, it is frequently necessary to connect users covered by different beams. In such cases, one beam's uplink channel will be connected to the corresponding channel of another beam's downlink. This does not invalidate the description given. There is still one receiver subsystem per beam or polarization, but some of the outputs of the demultiplexer filters are connected to amplifying chains belonging to different transponders. The interconnection between an uplink beam and three downlink beam may use one of the following methods. Interconnections whose configuration can be changed from time to time by means of electromechanical switches operated by ground, and the figure will be shown subsequently. This type of interconnection is used in Intelsat 5. Dynamic interconnections in TDMA with satellite switching between burst SS TDMA. This is carried out by means of onboard diode or transistor switching matrix, which connects each burst of an up beam frequency to amplifying chain to the amplifying chain of the destination down beam. This switching is subsequently operated by a command unit according to the traffic organization. The sequential order can be modified by ground command. The matrix introduces insertion losses, which must be offset by additional amplifiers, figure 5.7. Such system is found in Intelsat 6. The switches, command units, matrix, and all the interconnection must be set up in such a way that the level of the signal at the transponder inputs remain relatively constant irrespective of the switching and path traversed. Electromagnetic compatibility EMC must also be ensured, as far as coupling and induction caused by switch command pulses must be avoided. The characteristics of the satellite transponders are mainly influenced by the performance of the TWTS. Some of the factors involved are considered below. Hard limiting transponders. Hard limiting transponders include a limiting device which clips the incoming signal. This permits the traveling wave tube amplifier TWTA to be operated at saturation with output power almost independent of the repeater input power. However, multi-carrier operation is restricted because of intermodulation noise. Quasi-linear transponders, a TWT, will behave in a more linear fashion if the output power is backed off from saturation. Typically, a 4 to 6 dB backoff is necessary for FDMA operation. A smaller backoff is usually sufficient to reduce the spectrum spreading and in-band distortion with single carrier PSK transmission. Linear transponders. An ideal linear transponder would have a linear transfer characteristics up to the point where saturation occurs. Methods for improving the linear portion of the transponder transfer characteristics over that achievable with TWTA transponders are being approached in two different ways. So this is the example of an interconnection diagram between the antenna beams. So there are different filters are over there, and then there are different multiplexing system, then another set of filters over there. They are going to then filter and going to the output antennas. So that is another picture of TDMA using, in the previous picture, it is the example of an interconnection diagram between the antenna beams. So whenever it is feeding to the antenna, there are not only one set of filters, there are filter arrays are there, so that the signal and noise level should be discriminated well for the outputs part. And it is another example of TDMA using a switching matrix of the satellite. One approach is to improve the linearity of the TWTA transponders through the use of various linearizer configuration which have been developed using feed-forward, Butler matrix and pre-distortion technique. The other approach is to replace a TWTA with a solid-state amplifier based on FET technology. Which has an intrinsically more linear transfer characteristics when near saturation than a TWTA. Such amplifiers are being developed and show promise of improved linearity and reliability while avoiding the onboard mass and power penalties associated with the previously mentioned TWTA linearization techniques. Transponder research and development trends. The current major manufacturers of space qualified TWTAs include Thomas CSF Tube Electronics in Europe and Hughes in the United States. All have made significant improvement in the size, weight, power, and efficiency of these units during the last decade. Other groups involving making space-related TWTAs include NEC and Toshiba in Japan. In the next figure, A and B shows a summary of the TWT development at Thomas CSF and NEC Toshiba. Efficiency have progressed steadily to the extent that 60% are now achievable for 12 gigahertz bands. And additional improvements of from 5 to 7% are expected in future version, and if we consider modern condition, it may be more. Parallel with the development of TWTAs are electronic power conditioners, EPCs, to meet the multi-kilovolt ranges equipment by TWTAs. EPC efficiency of 90 to 93% DC input to high voltage output has been achieved for high power 200 to 260 watt TWTAs at 12 gigahertz. Solid state power amplifier SSPAs have been used extensively for low power 10 to 20 watt and a lower frequency 4 gigahertz applications and for phase array where power gain is distributed over a large of elements. The status of SSPA development in Europe and Japan is shown in the figure. At present, these devices have inferior efficiency and power capabilities compared to TWTAs. However, their inherent high reliability and convenient physical characteristics for space application have made them focus of intense development. It has been estimated by manufacturers of these devices that within a few years, 20 gigahertz SSPAs will be available, capable of 30 watt and RF power. High frequency applications are also forecasted for active phase array systems along with the advanced MMIC technology advancements. So this is the table. TWTA development by Thomas CSF Tube Electronics. Here frequency bands are from 1.5 to 80 GHz. RF output power corresponding 1.5 is 150 watt, and 2 here up to 20 gigahertz the power RF power is 15 to 140 watt, and for 30 to 80 it is broadband operating mode and technology available but not still working, it will be used in future. And broadband efficiency for the band of 1.5 is 49%, then 54, then 54 to 59, and up to 12 gigahertz the efficiency 60 to 64%, and for 20 gigahertz it is 50 to 60%. Typical gain is for 1.5 is 34 dB, and corresponding up to 20 gigahertz it is 60 dB. Nonlinear phase degrees are 1.5 is 40, and for 20 gigahertz it is 40 to 55. This table shows some specification how the efficiency achieved corresponding to frequency, and how the gain also achievable, and power consumption also showing. So this is a total TWT development of this Thomas CSF tube electronics. So according to requirement it is used. TWTA development in Japan. So correspondingly for the Japan technologies, how a technology they how they have grown, it is shown over there. For 12 gigahertz the saturated power is 120, efficiency is 59, voltage in kilovolt 6.7, weight is 3.3, manufacturer is NEC, Nippon Electronics Communication. Comments is 4 stage MDC, M type cathode, conductive cooling, and PPM focusing. And for 12 gigahertz, that is another specification is there. For 20, it is 10, 33, 4.9, 1.7, used on ETS V1. For 22, it is 200, 50.7, 12.3, and weight is 5 kg. So very lightweight they are, Toshiba and Nippon Electronics Corporation. Coupled active design used on comets. And the frequency of 44 gigahertz, saturated power is 20, and efficiency is 32, voltage in kilovolt 10 kilovolt, weight is 6.2, it is manufactured by NEC, used on comets. SSPA development reported in Europe. So for 2.5 gigahertz output power is 10 watt, gain is not given over there, efficiency is 40, manufacturer is Alcatel, and comments is up to 40 watt combined. So these are the specifications sheet, depending on the use it is used for designing satellite transponder. So SSPA developments reported in Japan. So they have used the band of 2.5 gigahertz to 38, corresponding output power is 2 watt to 110 watt, power is 0.5 watt, very low power output here. Efficiency is corresponding, best efficiency showing over 2.5 gigahertz, output power is 110, efficiency 42 by Fujitsu. Comments or application is 5 beam or 8 amplifiers. So transponder with onboard processing. In digital satellite system performed, and efficiency can be improved by using onboard processing transponder, which are capable of performing switching, regeneration or baseband processing. These techniques have not been widely used up to now in commercial satellites, but will find application in future. RF switching. Three types of RF switching operation can be investigated at microwave frequency. A. Switching information burst from one transmission RF channel to another. B. Switching information burst from one fixed spot beam to another. C. Switching a scanning spot beam from one earth station to another. Operation can be performed by an onboard frequency, agile frequency converter. It can provide interconnectivity among our station operating at different carrier frequencies. Operation B provides interconnectivity among our station accessing different spot beam by cyclically interconnecting the TDMA signals via an onboard time domain switching matrix. The microwave switch matrix is controlled by a programmable distribution control unit clocked by a stable time reference. Each earth station in the network synchronizes the transmission of its information burst to the program onboard switch sequence. In order to communicate with the earth station which access other beams, several configurations of this type have been analyzed and proposed. Operation C requires the implementation of a steerable beam. A satellite with a high gain steerable spot beam can give a total coverage to the entire service area while still providing the advantage of high antenna gain and a good efficiency of TDMA. In this system, the earth station in the network share a single RF channel in TDMA mode, while the steerable beam scans the service area in synchronization with the time division format. The regeneration transponders. If the transmitted digital information is recovered on board by regeneration, the uplink will be separated from the downlink and the following main advantages are obtained. The overall error ratio of the communication system is the sum of the error ratio of the up and downlink instead of being determined by the total carrier to noise ratio. Earth station and satellite EIRP can be thereby reduced. The effects of nonlinear distortion of the two links do not accumulate. Any onboard multipath interference arises from RF coupling among different channels is eliminated. The onboard modulators allow the onboard RF amplifier to be fed by signals which are virtually free from amplitude modulation and components. Therefore, the RF amplifiers can be operated at saturation level without significant performance degradation. In SS-TDMA system, onboard switching matrices can be realized by baseband circuits. These offer substantial advantages in terms of mass, size, power consumption compared to microwave switching matrices, which must be used with non-regenerative repeaters. The baseband switch matrix can consist of simple logic gates. Custom-built components could allow the realization of high-speed, large-dimension matrices with low power consumption and size. More flexible onboard redundant scheme can be conceived. A system master clock can be placed onboard, thus simplifying clock recovery and frame synchronization in SS-TDMA systems. The downlink can be made to operate in a continuous carrier mode, even in the case of TDMA, by the use of onboard demodulation. So, before going to the next section, we are ending the session today over there. And in the next classes, we will continue the session. So these are the references. And thank you.